Hello everyone, my name is Fideline Hermans from Leiden University, and in this lecture I'm going to talk about how to do computer science. Imagine you're designing a programming language, how would you know if it's better than any other programming languages? For this we have to understand the research methods that exist in computer science, and that's what this lecture is about. Even though it's a web lecture, active participation is required, so if you continue watching I expect you to really participate, so you consent by continuing to watch. But to make participation a little bit more fun, we have our friend the participation panda. So every time the panda shows up on the screen, this means you have to think about something and participate before you continue the rest of the video. As I said, this video is about how to design programming languages. There are many, many programming languages out there, at least a few hundred that are really very popular, and then thousands more that are created for small tasks or just for people's individual pleasure. And imagine you want to understand what programming language is best for what type of task. How do you go about measuring that? That's what this video is about today. There's the panda already, so this is the first participation moment. I just want you to think of a way to study this question. So imagine you have two programming languages and you want to decide which is better. Just take a moment, pause the video, take maybe a sheet of paper or your computer and write down how you would measure which programming language is better. How would you want to decide? Okay, so my guess here is that most of you, especially computer science students watching, will say experiments. Experiments are the best way to actually measure what programming language is better than what other programming language. And the way I know this is because I have a sense of the research culture that computer science shares, which is often the same culture as the natural sciences, as physics and chemistry and mathematics. If you go to our old building in the city center, this statue is in front of the old building of our faculty, and it says "Door meten tot weten," which means if we measure stuff, we get to more knowledge. This is the culture of science and often also the culture of computer science, because in many universities, including Leiden, the computer science department has a home within the faculty of science together with often chemistry, math, physics, that type of studies. So because of this, of course, not literally because of this statue, but because of the culture that we're in, computer science students often think that experimentation is the way, the only way to acquire knowledge. This might also be the case because often if we think of science, and this is in popular science as well, in TV shows and stuff like that, the scientific method is emphasized as a way of doing science. So just as a quick refresher, what is the scientific method? The scientific method typically consists of a number of steps, of which the first one is observation. So something happens and you're like, I want to study this phenomenon. And the most famous example of this, of course, is Newton sitting under a tree and an apple falling on his head. After the observation step in the method, you get the theory formation step. So now that you have observed something, you want to formalize this. And a theory can have the form of language, of words. You can say, well, a force must be causing this apple to fall. But often in physics or chemistry or math, the theory has the form of a formula. So you precisely write down, this is how I think stuff in the world interacts. After this, you form a hypothesis. So from your theory, you can say, well, the theory predicts that this apple, if I drop it, will fall to the ground. That's what's going to happen. And of course, once you have a hypothesis, you can verify this doing an experiment. And every experiment you do will increase your confidence in the theory, if it succeeds, that is. And after a while, you might gain real high confidence that your theory is actually valid. This is the overview again of the scientific method. So it's observation, theory, hypothesis, experiment. The goal of this lecture and the goal of one of the courses I teach at Leiden University called Psychology of Programming, which is a longer version of this talk, is to help students think of other ways to do science. So there's nothing wrong with the scientific method, but in computer science, typically our research methods are a little bit broader than just the scientific method. So the goal is to give some other ideas that you can use to measure, for example, the question, what programming language is the best programming language? If we look at the scientific method, you will see that it very much fits the natural sciences. If there is a world you can observe, then it very much makes sense to actually observe it. But there are other forms of doing science as well. There's not just the natural sciences, or beta, as we often call them in Dutch. There are other ways of doing science as well. For example, another brand of science, you could say, is called gamma, the social sciences, where you're not studying things, you're studying people. And a third form of doing research is called alpha in Dutch, the humanities, where you're studying stuff that people produce, for example, music or books or archaeological artifacts. And these different forms of science actually have way different research methods and research philosophies than from each other. They very much differ. And you can imagine that computer science borrows research methods from all three, because sometimes we study stuff that actually exists in the world, like very mathematical properties, like P is NP. There is such a thing as the polynomial equation. There is such a thing as an exponential equation. And we as computer scientists, we can only observe them. But sometimes we're also studying people. We're studying the behavior of people. Why do people create bugs? What programming language might influence that? And sometimes we even do alpha research, where we look at what type of programs have people created. Can we learn something from how that was designed? Much like you can read a book and understand how did the person that wrote the book think. So the scientific method is very much tied to the natural sciences. If you are observing a world that exists and that you cannot change by observation, it makes sense to just have an observation, a theory, a hypothesis, and an experiment. This very much fits the natural sciences. Whereas if you look at the social sciences, imagine doing the scientific method there. Well, it's hard because people know they're in an experiment. If you get people in the lab, for example, which we sometimes do, and we ask them, hey, here's a programming language and try it out, then they might, they know they're in an experiment, so they might show different behavior than they normally would. Maybe they are more self-conscious and then they make more mistakes, or maybe they're worried about making mistakes, so they might make less mistakes because, ooh, we're in an experiment, we have to do our best. So you can still do experiments, and people do experiments in the social sciences. However, these are often controlled experiments, where you have a control group and an experimental group, and people do not know in which group they are. And also the researchers don't know in which group the people are, because then they accidentally might also influence people. So experiments are still possible in the social sciences, but because people understand they're in an experiment, and apples or other stuff that might fall, they don't know they're in an experiment, so they will always show the same behavior. Experiments are valid, but they are still different. However, in the alpha sciences, in the humanities, imagine you're studying tools from 6000 BC, you can't really do an experiment. What you do is you observe, you look at many different tools, and then you say, well, my theory is these things were used, I don't know, to open walnuts. That's probably what they were used for, because walnuts existed at this time in this place and time. So this is a theory. It's not even a hypothesis, because an experiment won't follow. And sometimes in computer science, this is also what we do. Sometimes we just look at computer programs that people created and we form a theory. The end. So in computer science, these three forms of doing research all exist and are all valid ways of doing science. Now that we have looked at different ways of doing research, let's look at what the impact of this is on how to design programming languages. Imagine we have two groups of people. One group of people really loves JavaScript, and the other group of people really loves C#. And they're in a fight. They don't know what to do. They want to decide who is right, who has the best programming language. And they've agreed that they're going to measure something. So this is a question, of course. An interesting question is, what could they measure? Imagine we want to measure something. What could you measure? Time for the panda again. So maybe you want to pause the video. Think of this situation in which you have two programming languages and you want to decide which one is better. What are some of the things you can measure? You might want to write down one. You might want it down. Might want to write down a bunch of them. Just think of what are things you could measure. So what could we measure? Well, for example, we could measure which program is quicker. This is very often done and it's called benchmarking in programming language design. So you write a certain algorithm in different programming languages or different forms of the algorithm in one programming language, and you use a stopwatch and you see which of the programs is quicker. And this is a sort of a convincing argument. If one side of the argument can say, our programming language is quicker, the other people will say, well, okay, there's no arguing with a stopwatch. Your programming language indeed is quicker, so okay. But there are also other things we could measure. Maybe this is something you wrote down as well. You could count the number of lines of code that it takes to program the same algorithm in one programming language versus the other programming language. So one side could say, look, our program is shorter. We have 10 lines and you have 100 lines. So clearly we're better. But is that really better? Is 10 lines better than 100 lines? Is 200 lines better than one line? It isn't always so clear what programming language, what it is better. Is it better? Just to show you an example of this, let's have a look at the game of life. Game of life is an algorithm, you can see that here, in which there are a number of cells, and the cells can either be alive, which is yellow, or they can be dead, which is gray in this example. And there's a bunch of rules. The precise rules don't really matter at this point, to go from one stage to the other stage. So if a cell has many live neighbors, it will stay alive. But if it has no live neighbors or too many live neighbors, then it will die. So initially the board might be like this, and then like this, and then like this. So you step through different versions of the board. And this is something people really like to program in different programming languages. Let's look at two implementations of the game of life. Firstly, this is an implementation in C++. You see that this implementation takes almost 200 lines, 204, I think, yeah. So 200 lines. And then if you run the code, you see you get a very small version of the board, and then all the versions are printed underneath each other. So pretty small, not visualized super nicely, and it takes 200 lines. Let's look at the same algorithm in a programming language called APL. In APL, this line here that you see at the bottom, this is the only line we need, just one line, and then we get this. It looks really nice, the board is bigger, and it's just one line of code. But then you could argue, is this better? It is pretty impressive, but it's really, really hard to read. What do all the things mean that are in the bottom line? It's very hard to understand, to comprehend, whereas in C++, we could read one line and then the next line to get a sense of how the algorithm is working. So measuring something in terms of lines of code can be done, but it isn't always very clear where the threshold is. Something else that we could do is we could ask people. We could say, well, here's a bunch of programmers. What do you prefer? Do you prefer to work with C#, or do you prefer to work with JavaScript? I mean, just ask people, like random people on the street or on the internet, what their programming language of choice is between those two. And then in this example, 3 people say C# and 2 people say JavaScript, and one other person says, I don't like any of those languages, I have my own favorite. So then the C# people could say, look, we counted it, we tallied it, and more people like C# than like JavaScript. This is often the point where computer scientists say, yeah, this is unfair. It's easier to argue with these types of research methods the further away we get from the natural science research perspective. Because this is softer. People say, yeah, but who did you ask? How many people did you ask? Was there even a good representation? Was there a good sample size? And while these are valid questions, there are in fact ways to correctly calculate what big of a sample size you need. So there are ways to do this convincingly, and still, this research method just doesn't really fit the frame we have of computer science should be, is actually part of the natural sciences. However, of course, this is something we can measure, and if you do it fairly with a proper sample, it can definitely give you an insight into what programming language generally is seen as better. What we've seen so far, different forms of measuring stuff. We could measure speed, called benchmarking. We could measure the number of lines of code that are needed for the same algorithm. Or we could ask people in a survey, for example, what their opinion is. These forms of research are all called quantitative research, because in the end, what you measure is you get a quantity. the speed in seconds, the line of code in lines of code, the number of people that vote for C# over JavaScript. So the end result for both groups is a number, a quantity. And this is why it's called quantitative research. There are other methods as well, and that's what the rest of this lecture will be about things that aren't exactly quantitative research, or they don't result in a quantity. Imagine we're doing this. We ask people, how do you feel about C#? If you have to do C#, what would your feelings be? And people might say, well, it is hard, it is okay, I love it, it is complex, it is great, it is annoying. And then about JavaScript, people might say, wah, I don't like it, it is awful, I hate it, I'd rather eat stones than program JavaScript. And this already gives you a sense of how people feel about these languages. And from this, you could conclude that C# is better because there are more positive sounding answers. Question from the participation panel. This type of research where you ask people, how do you feel about JavaScript? Would you say this is quantitative? Is there a quantity involved? Just give yourself a few seconds to decide, is there a quantity here? And if so, what is the quantity? So I would say in this situation, it is still quantitative research because what we're counting is the number of positive answers. However, it is almost not quantitative anymore because it is harder to count now. Something like, okay, is this positive or is this negative? And should we have two positive points for I love it and one positive point for nah, it's okay, I can work with it, and two negative points for I don't really like it. So we are still counting the number of positive answers, but it is not entirely clear how we should count. Whereas again, in the number of lines of code, it's very clear what we're counting. There cannot be a debate on how many lines we're counting. Here, there's more vagueness, but still the goal is to count. So I would say this is quantitative research. There's also research, though, that is clearly not quantitative. It isn't meant to count or to measure anything. For example, we could ask people, what makes you like JavaScript? Assume you like JavaScript, or subscribe to the survey if you like JavaScript. What makes you like it? These are just some of the things people might say. They might say, I like JavaScript because it doesn't have a compiler. I like JavaScript because it's very easy to deploy. You can just deploy it in the browser. You don't need a runtime. But also people could say, well, I like JavaScript because my friends all use JavaScript, and then we can go to JavaScript conferences or clubs together. Those are also very valid reasons to like a programming language. This type of research is qualitative in nature. So here we're also asking opinions, also in a survey, just like we did in the quantitative version. But this is qualitative because we are not aiming to measure, we're aiming to understand. Other forms of doing qualitative research is, for example, to study the experiences people have. An example of this could be a diary study in which you learn a new programming language and you keep a diary. Every day you write down, well, I tried Haskell today and I was really fighting with the type system and it was really hard. This is also a way to gain an understanding of how a programming language works. And you can also ask opinions in an interview. So in a survey, the answers might be very limited because people just type a few words. But in an interview, one-on-one, you could solicit as an interviewer more deep responses. And those are all examples of qualitative studies in which the goal really is to understand something and not to measure something. And the reason this matters for programming language design is, imagine you do an experiment. Imagine one group of people C# and one group of people JavaScript. And the JavaScript people, they just always win. I know they're happier and they're quicker and they have the appropriate number of lines of code. It is clear. But then imagine you're creating your own programming language. What have you learned from the experiment? The only thing you know is that JavaScript is better. But imagine you want something else. You want to just make some changes to your programming language. What parts of JavaScript do you keep? What are the parts of JavaScript that will actually impact speed and readability and all those type of things? You don't really know. So just measuring might not help you in the design of new programming languages. In qualitative research, if you ask people, what do you like about a certain programming language? Then this can help you design new programming languages or tweak, change existing programming language. That is the goal of qualitative research. The goal is really to understand and not to measure. And just to give you an example of a potential result of a study that I've done into programming language design, for example, if people use a block-based programming language, like Scratch, for example, in which you click blocks together rather than type lines of code, if people use such a language, what they really value is the space in which they can put different blocks. That's something that they really, really appreciate. And this, again, is a result that helps you to design other programming languages. You might think, oh, what people really like is space to put ideas. This is something that I can then program in a new programming language. Question from the participation panel. Given, again, you have two programming languages, A and B, think of one qualitative and one quantitative way of evaluation. You can just pause the video if you want to think about it a little bit longer. What is one thing you could think of that is qualitative and one thing that is quantitative? And I would like to challenge you to go into a little bit of detail, because clearly you could say a survey, which would be qualitative. Actually, it can also be quantitative. So be a little bit more precise. Write down, I would do a survey in which I ask people ... For example, I ask them what their favorite programming language is, or I ask them what programming language from a group of 10 they would choose. Think in a little bit of detail, one qualitative and one quantitative evaluation. Another thing that you can do once you have done qualitative research is you can really okay, I hope you came up with really, really nice examples. We will make sure that for the people that participate in the Leiden version of this video, you can submit your answers and we'll actually give you some feedback on the answers. Imagine you've done qualitative work so far. So you have asked people in your survey or in your interview, for example, what makes you like JavaScript? Now, what are you going to do with the answers? If you're just tallying, if you're just counting, well, who likes to do this, then it is easy. You can say, well, 5 people like this, 3 people like this, ta-da, one side has won. But if you have open text, it's a little bit harder to look at it. And there are specific techniques to analyze open text data to get a better sense of what is going on. If you look at those answers as a researcher, you could look at what are the categories of things that people talk about. For example, all the stuff that is marked now are technical aspects. Functional programming, the compiler, the fact that you can program JavaScript on the back end and the front end, those are technical aspects. And if you go through these things, you can make groups of answers that belong together. There are also social aspects. If people like a programming language because other people like a programming language, that doesn't really have anything to do with how the programming language is designed. Zooming into the technical aspects, you can again make subcategories of these. You could say, well, the fact that programming JavaScript doesn't require a compiler and allows for functional programming, those are technical aspects concerning the programming language. Whereas the fact that it's easy to deploy and the fact that it runs on the back and the front end are technical aspects concerning the environment of the language. This, again, doesn't have anything to do with the syntax of the language. This example also really nicely illustrates why it's so important for computer scientists to do this type of work. Because you might say, well, if we're interviewing, we might just give these interviews to social scientists and then they can analyze the interviews. But these type of answers, you see that it's really important to have understanding of programming languages, because if you give this to a social scientist, they might be like, what is Node.js and what is a compiler? And of course, they could learn those things and they could totally look it up if it's a written interview. But in a one-on-one interview, you really have to have a deep understanding of the topic to have a discussion with someone, to say, okay, tell me more about how the lack of a compiler makes you like a programming language more. So it is important in this type of research that you do have a good grounding in computer science to be able to come up with great questions, but also some understanding of how to conduct an interview and how to analyze the open text data. So it isn't like, well, this is computer science and we just create programming languages and then other people can analyze them. Of course, there is a model that some people follow, but I very much prefer to, as a computer scientist, know a little bit about these research methods so I can myself gain an understanding of how people like or don't like programming languages that we create. There are clear methodologies for this. So again, this is in the realm of the social sciences, and computer scientists might think, this is just looking at data and making some categories, it's all a bit vague. There are very clear methodologies for this. One example of this that is also covered in the master's course Psychology of Programming is called grounded theory, in which you have a very structured way of analyzing open text data in a number of steps to gain categories and subcategories from open text data. This was my lecture about computer science and the types of research methods that are commonly used in computer science. If you want to ask questions, answer questions like what programming language is best and why.